a pleasure to meet Professor Peter Schneider from Munster, and we saw adventures that came from Budapest to have these days of all kinds of disturbances, traffic in and out from from Germany. So yeah, I'm an outsider. So
what kind of adventures? Budapest is a very beautiful and civilized city. So.
Maybe stop here.
So we work the past to the so-called derived category. precise definition. The point is the objects are the same objects. Are the same, but the homomorphisms are changed. Namely, there is the notion, so there is the notion here in this category, there is the notion of a quasi homomorphism. Which means, I mean, you see, if you have, let's say, let's look at one step here, we have a
the algebra carries a differential
first of all such that, I mean, first of all, this is a K-linear map. K-linear map. So we can again speak of quasi-isomorphism. When a homomorphism of such modules is a quasi-isomorphism, we can speak of quasi-isomorphisms. And again, we can declare them, I mean, the formal term is one has to invert them, but then we can declare them to be isomorphisms. So declaring them. Derived category of this dimension-graded algebra. So the objects are these modules, they're differential dependent modules for the algebra, and with the home office something similar is done as it did before. We'll see later first general and at the end a very specific example of such an algebra. Okay, so maybe now tell you why I'm interested in these notions. And let me do this on a very specific situation of any an interesting situation. Finite extension of the paired numbers f. And I take as a, I mean, then there is, maybe I need this later, OF string of usual notations. I'm actually not sure how much of this I need. Yeah, I think I do need this in a moment. OF string of integers, discrete variation, pi f the prime element. And then the residue class field, right, OF, pi f, is of course a finite field, which is a FQ finite extension. So then I take for the first notion, I take now, for the purposes of this talk, one specific example, I take the group SL2 over this field. Right, I mean, this is, let's say, the matrix entries given embedding in F to four-dimensional F at the space, and therefore the topology of F induces a topology on this group and it becomes a topology group. And in there, I consider a specific subgroup, all matrices in G. In actually, let me put the first condition right here, in not in SL2 of over the ring, yeah, the ring of integers, with the following additional conditions. So no condition on B, but A and the diagonal entries, A and D, should be congruent 1, not pi. And the lower entry should actually be congruent 0. So this is a so-called Hecke-Hogarth group. And I leave it as an exercise. On the one hand, this is an open subgroup. Yeah. And secondly, it's a OP group. It's OP. So any finite factor group, I mean, should maybe be careful, by a open subgroup factor. I mean, whenever you take an open normal subgroup in I, then the quotient is finite, of course, and is a P group. That's very easy to see if you know something about the ring and the quotients by the powers of the maximal idea. So now I consider a left exact functor from the smooth G. vectors under the subgroup. So all V, which are fixed by all elements G. So now there is actually more structure, yeah? That's what I call X in the following, the shorter notation. Now we can do the following. We can consider the endomorphism ring of this induced representation. So the G endomorphisms of X, some ring, of course, at first some abstract ring, which I denote by H. Although it depends on I, but let me just, maybe I even drop the, yeah, maybe I write it better if I write it HI, maybe the alien group is misunderstood. And actually, just for as a convention, I take the opposite way. And you see, then this acts from the right.
Because
H0 is the functor. The formally correct notation would be maybe this. Abbreviated this by H0.
So it's.
Secondly, let's assume our field K, little k, has characteristic 0. So finite groups have no, if you have a finite group and a complex representation of it, then the group has no higher cohomology in a complex representation. And the same holds for profinite groups. So then you see all the higher cohomology groups, hi, I, b, are 0, for I, bigger than 0, so if I take it for h1, and that means the functor is actually exact, follows the functor h0 is exact. And in this case, there's a deep theorem. There may be representations V for which the which have no fixed vector except 0. Right? Then of course this module doesn't know anything about them. So we have to pass here to a subcategory. So on the left hand side, subcategory of all V which are generated as a representation by the fixed vectors. There is no proper sub-representation which contains all the fixed vectors. If you restrict this to this subcategory, and here we still have the full category of modules, then Robert Bernstein showed that then this functor is an equivalence of categories. So that means at least on such a subcategory, these modules completely reflect all the information one can have about these representations. Now, okay, let's go to the other extreme. That's all I'm interested in the following. That the characteristic of little k is p. The same p, and we started with a finite extension of qp. So the same p as above. Then, of course, this argument breaks down completely. And the cohomology of I in a, so to speak, modular representation is highly non-trivial. Then the functor H0 has element properties. Except in very few and very special situations.
So, excuse me for the naive question, you said that this theorem for Angerskin is very deep, but intuitively it's somehow not so surprising.
You think so? Why?
Well, you are restricting to the invariance by I, so.
Why should they know the.
They know all about the representation.
The representation is built out.
Yeah, sure. You think because I wrote here generated by, but yeah.
What
does it mean? This doesn't say anything about the relations for this generation, right?
Sure. I don't say it's easy to prove, but I'm just saying.
maybe one it's specific to, I mean, it would not hold for I mean, there are groups, open compact subgroups of SL2F, yeah, for which this does not hold. So it's, it has to do also with specific properties of this I. So it's not a formal statement. I mean, certainly not a formal statement. Okay, so the functor here, this has no chance. The functor H0, I mean, it's plausible, right, in some sense that this cannot really be true if I have higher cohomology, then the higher cohomology should come into the picture in some sense. And that's, in fact, exactly what I want to explain. Right? I mean, the presence of now higher cohomology of I suggests that we should derive the situation. And it's not sufficient to derive the functor. We also have to derive, in a certain sense, the Hecke algebra, the construction of R. I didn't say this. This is called the Hecke algebra. This here is called the Hecke algebra of I. Or maybe to be precise, of the PRG comma I. So we already have to derive the notion of Hecke algebra, and that leads to a differential equation. This is done by introducing a differential equation algebra. Explain how this is abstractly, how this is done, and state the theorem, and then we discuss the simplest example of this whole situation. And let me assume now all the time, without mentioning again, that the characteristic of K is P. So, how do we derive the algebra? So the first easy fact one has to know is that this abelian category of smooth substitutions has enough injective objects. That one can do the usual homologic algebra in it. In particular, right, this allows us to replace X, I mean, fix A, we had our representation X up there. No, it's not limited anymore. The induction. And we can choose an injective resolution. Term H I, maybe I write I mean, should maybe I write this again, I 0, I 1, I 2, and so on, and we want to have look at endomorphisms. So, in degree j, we take the product over all integers q, and then the g homomorphisms from HQ to HQ plus J. Yeah, so if let's say J is 1, then we take in each, we start with any of these I's here and take the 0 to 0 plus 1 is 1 to 2. So one term is the homomorphism from I0 to I1. And the next term is those from I1 to I2, and so all those which go up and one to the right. No conditional commutativity here. Absolutely none. Just all maps, all G maps, which we have the product of all. And in degree 2, we get those which go up and but 2 to the right. Or there are, of course, negative degrees. If I have minus 2, I go up and 2 to the left, right? I mean, that would sit in minus 2, h max. So that's the gradient. The direct sum of these vector spaces is the algebra, where the multiplication is basically the composition. In some sense, do the op here. So let me formally write it down, although I think it's easiest if you just think of it as being the composition. In this business, there is also always the issue of science. One has to distribute science. I think at first seeing this, you can neglect that. Plus J composed with EQ. And I can just take, if I have something here, let's say the B1, and then I have another arrow, which now goes 3 to the right, I can compose the 2 and get an arrow which goes up in 4 to the right. Adds the degrees exactly as the condition on the multiplication was. And the differential you see for the differential again, let me write down the precise formula, but then only explain it. Again, there's a sign, and then a q plus 1 dx. So let me expand this again in this picture. So let's assume these are our a's. Right, these are our a's. A0, A1, and so on. And now remember that the d has to raise the degree, so this has to be an arrow which goes 2 to the right. So what I can do is, I go up with this and then take the d here, right, and go 1 further to the right. This is what I did here. First the arrow and then the d. I'm ending up here. But this was a choice. I could have done this here. I could go first with the d and then go up with A1. I end up in the same target. And now it's degree 2, it's going the 2 to the right. And this is what I have done here, and there have to be signs. Right? And this makes sense because I didn't require that these quadrangles here are commutative. So this is really going here and going here, is something completely different. Right? So the difference is something new, the new memory. Okay. So that derives the algebra. Now similarly, one can derive the functor h0. Objects, right? An object here was a complex of these. And I can now do the same. I mean, then I use the endomorphisms for the formal constructions, didn't play any role. I can do the same here, I can look at the homomorphisms, G-homomorphisms from the complex, from this injective resolution into the complex E dot. And that's then a differential graded module over this differential graded algebra. What I explained here, I think for some of this I did not use that these were the same, the two were the same complex, so these definitions work also if I have homomorphisms between, consider homomorphisms between two different complexes. So the theorem is now if the group I does not contain an element of order P, then H is an equivalence of, I mean, these derived categories, they are no longer, they are not abelian categories, they are what one calls triangulated categories. It's not important right now what this means. I just want to make the formal and correct statement, triangulated of triangulated categories. Maybe another exercise.
So G is no longer SL2?
In the moment, yes, I said this in the moment I make comments. So first it still is, and then again a new exercise. When is the assumption satisfied? That's in general maybe a bit complicated, but let's assume our F is QP. Then assumption satisfied. Any p different from 2 and 3. And if you, I mean, p has to be in some sense large compared to the extension equation in general. Okay, so again, a few comments, and then we look at an example. What does this assumption really mean? I mean, the assumption I means that I has finite cohomological dimension. So only that's only finite for any representation that only finding many cohomology groups which do not match. That's exactly, I mean, this is a proposition, of course, it's not a definition, it's a proposition that this holds in it only if the group has no, the boogie group has no elements in finite order.
Isn't it Lazar?
That's basically, you know, I think Lazar, yeah, not only, I think it's in Sales, he uses Lazar, of course. Second, otherwise I couldn't discuss the upcoming example, the theorem holds for any pair G, I where G is a pair in the group. And I is an open for piece of group. Without elements of order G. And okay, what's the relation to the who sees what the relation to the original Hecke algebra is? You see, I mean the algebra is a complex, right? There's a d times d is zero, so h dot I is in particular a complex, so we can form its cohomology. Which is now only a graded algebra, a graded car algebra. There's no differential anymore because we have mastered the cohomology with respect to the differential. And the fact is, I mean, this sits, has actually only five limiting terms, sits in degrees 0 to the cohomological dimension. Because in fact, I mean, if you look at this, this is not difficult to see, but I don't have time to really show it to you. Then you see that this has a more concrete meaning. So this is the cohomology of I in our big representation X. And from this one can deduce that the original algebra HI, our original Hecke algebra, is nothing else than the zeros cohomology of the new differential graded algebra. Okay. So now let's finish by discussing the simplest example, which is in some sense conceptually maybe not, it's not interesting at all, but it demonstrates all these notions. One in the field, and therefore let me denote by gamma. What is the category of smooth ZP representations? And that's what we started with. And actually, this is all well-known things, namely, these are the torsion modules, it's the same as the category of torsion modules over the formal power series in one variable T over our field K. And it's very simple. If you have a smooth representation here, right, you have to let T act on it. So we take as a vector space, it remains unchanged, it goes to V, and we let T act, it's a K vector space already, right? Yeah. Anyway, so what is T with T acting as gamma minus 1? One is not the one in the field. I let T act as gamma minus 1. Of course, one has to check that then, to let T act doesn't suffice, power series that one has to check that. But since it's a torsion, the torsion comes from the smoothness condition here translates into the torsion condition here. And this one can use to check that really power series that in T act. Discrete valuation, and we do know everything about these torsion modules. This is easy. So the next thing was these injective resolutions. Now for this, let me introduce the following representation. These are all k-valued, locally constant functions of g. The infinity refers to the locally constant condition. And I let act with left translation action of G. So this is then smooth. This is a smooth representation. Checks this smooth representation. And what's the endomorphisms? And G, C infinity G, K, is nothing else, this thing is nothing else than this power series thing. It's clear that this sits in there, right? And this is a smooth representation, so by this recipe, it is a module over this ring, and therefore, because the ring is commutative, any element is an endomorphism of this module. The statement here is that there is really nothing more than the obvious endomorphisms. And three, this is an injective object, and actually, much stronger, any V in what K G has the injective resolution. So we can write down an explicit injective resolution. I'm tensoring with this an example where the original Hecke algebra is trivial, so that we only see the derived phenomena. We take Si the full group. I take G equal to Cp. So take and then, of course, the x is trivial because the induction from a group, right, when nothing happens. So x is just the k, and so this means also the original Hecke algebra in this case is just a field, little k. But what is the derived one? So we took, what did we do? We took an injective resolution of x. Now let's do this here. So you see we have the injective resolution we have to look at. I'm writing the I dot, what is it? Right? I mean, this is not part of it. We look at this here, but it starts of course only with the injective objects. Now this is k, so it disappears. It's just c infinity g k to c infinity g k, and then comes zeros. And this map is just f goes to t times f, so it's multiplication by t. And from this we can easily read off what now the derived Hecke algebra is. So remember, in a certain degree J here, we took all maps from some term to the term 1 up and J to the right or left, whether J is negative or positive. As soon as I go here 2 to the right, I end up with 0, right? I go from here 2 to the left, I end up with 0. Nothing happens there. So the only interesting degrees are minus 1, 0, and 1. If I have minus 1, right, this, so then the arrow goes this way, starting here, I end up at 0, forget it. Here, I end up here where we have the same thing. So I have an endomorphism of this C infinity Cg, which is kt by 2. So in degree minus 1, I just have kt. Now in degree 0, right, arrows go just up. I have, of course, here an arrow, and I have here an arrow, both endomorphisms of C infinity. So I have two copies of K. This is degree 0. And then in degree 1, the arrow goes this way. So here, nothing happens, goes to 0. I again have only one copy. Then I have zeros. So that's the differential graded algebra where the maps, of course, can easily be worked out. So let me just write the result here. A goes to TA, TA. And here, A, B goes to T times B minus A. A minus B. So that's the differential. Now I would have to tell you the multiplication can easily be worked out, but the formula is a little bit more lengthy. It's easier to do the following. Let's write another complex. Let's write here just the complex. One copy. Only K. K. Here one copy of K, and here one copy of K. Here 0. Here we have 0 already. Yeah. And then this, of course, the 0 map. This is just the inclusion. And here I take as map A goes to A, A. And then you observe. So the vertical arrows is a quasi-resolution. I mean, first of all, you easily check. I think you can do this by listening. this is all commutative, right? All these squares are commutative. But the maps is a quasi automorphism. I didn't tell you what the map here is, right?
Zero map.
This is the zero map, exactly. Yeah. And therefore, now I can tell you that I do not really tell you what the algebra structure here is. I tell you what, if I fug it here, what it becomes here. So, hi dot is quasi isomorphic. The algebra of dual numbers, the algebra of dual numbers, K epsilon, right? K epsilon modulo epsilon squared. Viewed as a differential, I mean, this is a bit exotic, but what we do now, viewed as a differential graded algebra, right? K plus, in degree 0 we have K, and in degree 1 we put K epsilon. But the multiplication is the multiplication of this algebra with differential 0. Easy to check that the axioms from the beginning are satisfying. So again, this is an algebra, and if we put this in degree 0 and then this in degree 1, it's graded. And then as a differential we take 0. Yeah, okay. I should stop. I think I can stop. So this describes, at least up to quasi-isomorphism, this describes very explicitly, right, in this case, the algebra. I could also describe explicitly the functor, but I'm going to stop here. Thank you very much.